7 Direct will show you how to increase your sales.
The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. To myself, what a wonderful world.
Welcome back to Sports World. Well, it's been a busy day and it continues to be a busy day. We've got children in the studio. I think that child's dad is about to be on television. Well, I remember singing the praises of Michael Tuck earlier in the season when Hawthorn had won the Knight Premiership, and here he is. Three losses only later, a record margin in a grand final. Michael Tuck, congratulations.
Oh, thanks, Drew.
Sensational. Twice you've held the Premiership Cup up there. And I mean, are you going to keep going?
I don't really know. I just have to wait and see what the club says. But I was very happy with the performance of everybody yesterday, so it's made it so much better for everybody to enjoy the night.
What about the motivation? Was it the loss last year, as Greg Healy sort of alluded to, or just the, you wanted to prove that you were the best football team in Australia? What?
Well, we're the best side all year, and to lose the grand final would have been a sour note, and to be there would have been a sixth time, and to lose, we've only won two, so we didn't make the most of the opportunities, actually. So we wanted to make amends and make at least 50-50 record yesterday.
Tucky, you've always been very, very fit, no injury problems, but this year you had that calf. You got a back problem, I suppose, through your work. How is the body standing up to it?
Actually, it's not too bad, really. I sort of wasn't involved a lot yesterday, but I've got no problem. Once I got over calf muscle, I had no worries at all, really.
Michael, you've played under quite a few coaches at Hawthorn. It was interesting that Alan George should be thrown into this position just for the 1 year. What are the attributes that might stand out of Alan Joyce compared with the previous coaches that you've played under?
I think I've been a bit spoiled in respect to all the good coaches I've had, but George's main attribute, he was just straight down the line and just wanted the best out of the players, and he got the best out of the players, so that's his best attitude, to get the best out of the players. And he was sort of wanted everybody to make a commitment before the year, and everybody did it, and we got the end result.
Had he earned unbelievable respect as the football manager? Did that make it easier for him to take over as coach?
Well, I suppose we knew him before he started, so it would have helped a bit, because he'd been around with Junes a fair bit last year, and that, so it did help.
Michael, where do you feel that there's the biggest improvement on Hawthorn this year compared to, say, last year?
I think the biggest thing was to get top spot, because we just missed out on that. I think that week's break makes a big difference. And I think just the attitude of the players this year, we went for a purpose, and that was to win the grand final, and that's the way it worked out. I think it's just the attitude.
Michael, when you said Alan Joyce was straight down the line, with you, does he give you an easy time at, you know, at your age? I'm not being critical like that, but I mean, does he rest you at odd times when the others work hard, or is it a, does he have individual training for different players?
No, everybody trains the same, but Chris Muir and myself, we live so far away, on a Monday night we didn't have to come down the Hawthorn football ground, so we just could go for a run at home, but we had to train the same as everybody else. Pre-season was the same.
Right.
Tucky, Hawthorn are the family club, and they plan into the future. They looking at your two boys, I mean, it is the sire of Michael Tuck and out of the dam of Fay Ablett. Hell of a breeding there. Those kids coming along.
Turns out as good as you, Ron, they'll be very happy.
Oh. I think Ress want to know if you're going in the Magic Million sale.
You, Ron?
How much percent do I get?
Ron, we were all told not to mention the streak a bit yesterday, so, and you've brought something up like that. It's, I mean, on a day like today.
The streaker.
Can I just say something to Michael? Michael, there is a lot of experience in the Hawthorn side, but McGuinness, Collins, Whitman, those type of kids coming through, I mean, it's a terrific blend, isn't it? I mean, Hawthorn have just turned those young players over.
Yeah, well, yesterday there was four players who played their first premiership, win or loss, so we had a bit of both. We had experience plus the youth and enthusiasm, so I think if you can get both together, it's a big help, really. That's where Melbourne were a little bit underdone in the respect they didn't know what it was all about.
Any spares for Geelong? What do you think, Mal?
Tucky. Why wasn't Don Scott invited along to the celebrations last night?
I'm not really sure. I think he wrote a bit of a mention as the bus went past him, but he played for
the we should question that, because, you know, was there word down at Hawthorn about Scotty giving a serve to his old club? I mean, because he got heaps from your boys.
Well, to be honest, there was a bit of a mention before the game, yes.
Right. What was it?
Well, it's just what was in the paper or something. I didn't read it, actually. I don't read the paper because I write a lot of rubbish. Some of them.
Terrific, Michael. Just cruising along there, and I'm sure you're going to be back next year to overtake Bernie Quinlan, become number two on the ladder.
Retire now, Tucky.
Well done, Michael. Look, already there's a T-shirt on the market, and it's got Premiers 1988, Hawthorn, even the score, the record margin. There you go, mate.
Oh, thanks, Drew.
I believe actually they're on sale somewhere tomorrow.
Are they?
Hmm. And also you can get the Herald poster, which is on sale. You can buy it from the Herald. I think they cost $1. And the proceeds of that go to the Children's Hospital. And there it is, Hawks Premiers 1988. I think there'll be kids all around the place decking their bedrooms out with the Herald poster for the season. Well done, Michael Tuck.
Very nice, thank you very much.
And I honestly thought that you were going to be a big chance on Brownlow night, and there I was, and I waited about round 12 before you cracked a mention.
Yeah, all those blokes stealing votes off me.
Now, you've had an absolutely great year. I mean, after all the controversy when it went through the courts that were you going back to Perth, were you going to stay at Hawthorn, must be very pleased with the way it all washed up.
Yeah, it has turned out well. To play in another premiership is been fantastic, and to be part of a great club is also fantastic, so it's worked out well for me.
What was the real reason for you to come back to Hawthorn when it looked as though you were a certainty to go back home to Perth?
Well, the reason why I wanted to go to Perth was there was a lot of family reasons involved in that move, and seemed the natural thing for me to do is to go back there to settle the family problems and also be able to play in the VFL back there. But it was so easy for me to come back to Hawthorn because I never had any problems with the club or anything, and the players or anything like that. So it was just a natural thing to come back, and I thank them for the way they accepted me back. It was great.
Bucky, knowing you fairly well, what effect really did the streaker have on you when she ran out in the ground? Because you seemed to fire up after that.
What are you insinuating?
Well, I was just asking him what he thought about the whole incident. I was a bit disappointed. It never happened when I was playing.
Yeah, I was a bit disappointed you didn't come over and give me a kiss like Billy.
Was there any real pressure out on the ground for Melbourne at any stage, Gary?
Oh, I thought the turning point was about 15 minutes into the second quarter. It was pretty tough in the first quarter, I thought it was, desperate. And when the rain came, it made it pretty tough. And about halfway through the second quarter, we all seemed to lift our rating. And we got a few goals, and you could just feel the momentum of the game change.
Some of the highlights of your season, as we have a chat to you, was it the turning point when the Hawks just rushed it down like a tidal wave and about a dozen blokes just forced it forward in rugby fashion?
Yeah, I don't really remember that as too much, but a lot of people have spoken about that. They reckon it was just amazing.
Well, nobody got a kick or a hand pass or anything.
No, it was just sort of shunted down the ground, which was amazing. I'd like to see that, actually.
You went into last year's grand final really very, very tired. Made you pretty determined to get the week's rest, I guess, this year.
Well, yeah. Well, when you look at the season, it's such a long season now. That was my 32nd game yesterday with the 2 weeks off. So, had we gone the 4 weeks, we'd been something like 35 games. 36
practice matches, isn't it?
Yeah. Right. Interstate Carnival before the year and whatever. So it makes it an enormously long season. So those 2 weeks, I think, they're so vital.
Gary, when you're out on the ground nowadays and the scuffles start and the umpires just stand back about 20 yards and are watching the game up the other end, does that make any difference at all? They don't seem to worry about it, do they?
Well, I suppose they stand back to see who's hitting who.
It would appear from the outside as though there were plenty of blows struck, but they don't really do anything about it. They're virtually watching up the ground more. Mm. The game goes on.
Well, they picked one bloke out yesterday.
You dirty, ugly player. I mean,
you been reported before?
No, I haven't. No.
First time.
Yeah.
First ever report.
Well, what do you think about all that wrestling that goes on these days?
A lot of it is just that. It's pushing.
Show wrestling.
Oh, it's show of strength, I suppose.
Well, Bucky, congratulations on an excellent season. 10 big ones in there, $10 goes a long way.
Thanks very much. Thank you, while I've got the opportunity, thank Channel 7 for the award. Thank you, gentlemen, for your votes. They're very nice. And thank you to all the players at Hawthorn Footy Club and the people around the club, because that's what makes it such a great club, and no individual, really. It's just an effort from the whole entire team and the entire football club. So thanks very much.
Well said. Well said. Gary Buckenara, an absolute ornament to the game. We'll be back to discuss the grand final after the break.
It's very pleasing for me personally, Drew, but the team's bigger than the individual, and that's what we set out to erase last year's grand final loss, and the boys certainly played well yesterday.
You did one as a wingman. What were you yesterday?
Well, I started off in the back pocket, and then at quarter time, Joycey said, with Chrissy Whitman going off, that you could go in the centre and just mind Greg. He was running up and down the ground most of the first half, and I was just lucky enough to get in the right spot at the right time.
True, that was terrific. You've just taken my question. I had the pleasure of voting on the North Smith medal yesterday. It was a well-deserved win, Gary, and obviously being unanimous was a terrific effort. You've mentioned that with Healy, with young Whitman going off and you're on the ball. It looked at me as though you really enjoyed the run up the ground, that you're around to get round to the wings and centre and all that sort of stuff. I mean, was a bit of a release for you from the last two or three games?
Yeah, it was, because predominantly I am playing in the back line, but this year Alan Joyce has given me a bit of scope to move up and down the ground, and I certainly enjoy being where the action is, and I think it allows me to set the ball further up the field for our teammates.
Gary, your style's changed since you first came down to Hawthorn. You're a flighty forward, a centre line player. Few injuries, you've really had to adapt your style. I mean, even your running style's changed.
Yes, I originally came down as a forward, and I then got put in the back line, and Alan Jeans gave me the opportunity to play there, and I've just sort of adapted myself around playing on the back line. I think if we can use that as a springboard of attack for the way Hawthorn's game is played, which is just running in numbers down the ground, I think that's better for me personally and also for the side.
Do you think the players make you look fast? The players playing today make you look fast, Ayrsy?
Oh, I don't know about that, Scotty. I don't know.
Well, they seem to get out of the way and let you go through.
Oh, perhaps I learnt that from you, mate, I'm not sure.
Gary, most of the Hawthorn players that come in have got a great deal of sincerity about them and a humble thing about them. Is that, and I don't want to appear callous in saying this, is that sort of a prepared political statement by the Hawthorn Football Club, or is it the way that you genuinely feel about the club?
Oh, I think that's the way I genuinely feel. I think it's a pretty low-key club. They don't ever attract a lot of publicity, and I think that's been born from, 40, 50 years ago, and it's been carried on through John Kennedy, Alan Jeans, the committee.
Really, we're a happy team at Hawthorn. Is a genuine thing?
Oh, I think so, and I think it's proved that we're probably the most successful club, since perhaps 1970, except by winning those premierships. So I think it's the best way to go, really.
Good. Gary, do you find any extra pressure on yourself personally, or you could sense in the team, and Hawthorn was sitting there sort of expected to win the grand final yesterday?
Yeah, I think it was, Kel, because everyone had picked us to win, and we went in pretty short price favourites, but I think this year we were the superior side. We ended up on top of the ladder, and then we beat Carlton in the second semi-final, had that week's break, and I think the end result was a pretty good thing for the club.
How do you prepare yourself now for these overseas trips? How do you take them?
Well, I'm not looking forward to them too much, because it's just another thing on top of what we've already done. And as Alan Joyce has been saying, we've been going since January the 11th, and it's a lot of training and 6 or 7 months of really hard work. But, I suppose now that we've won, we can just sit back and enjoy it anyway.
Gary, you had this injury at quarter time. Just how bad is that jaw? Because, you're talking okay, you look okay.
Yeah, apparently it's a depressed fracture of the cheekbone, so I think I have to go in hospital on Tuesday and get it fixed up, so I'll be in hospital for about a day.
Won't stop you going on the trip, though.
No, it doesn't hurt as much today, anyway.
Just stop him playing on the trip.
Conan the Destroyer is his nickname.
Yeah. I think he dived in front of a tram going downhill. Well played, Gary.
Thanks very much, Drew.
Gary Ayres in Sports World this morning, and for the second time, the Norm's... Welcome back to Sports World, and if he can recover, Bob Davis about to tell us about the defence in the grand final.
Well, Calvin, I thought that Ayres was easily outstanding as the defender, wasn't he?
He's a normal person, that's for sure, but I thought Ayres, Langford and Collins combined pretty well, and I think
Collins was fantastic
early.
I
thought so, yes. It was a complete contrast in defences, I thought. I thought Melbourne really fell apart. All they'd built up over the last couple of weeks, really.
Of course, only a few of the players have arrived as such.
We've had them all in here.
Well, Jason Dunstall apparently left here at 9 o'clock this morning, so I don't know what time he's going to get here this afternoon. But we all hear about Robert Dippier Domenico, and we hear about Brereton, we hear about Dunstall and Mew. I've got one of the unsung heroes here with me, Drew. Andrew Collins, who played an outstanding game yesterday in the back pocket. Andrew, it must have been one of the greatest thrills of all time for you.
Oh, it was the ultimate. Absolutely the ultimate. It's something that I've aimed for ever since I've started playing football, and I finally achieved it.
Now, the atmosphere when you ran out in the ground yesterday, floating on air?
No, actually, I tried to block it all out of my mind. I actually sort of heard nothing, so that was a good sign straight away that I had my mind tuned on to the game, so I didn't hear that much at all.
It must be terrific for a youngster like you, and I say that, it's true, you're still a young player in, well, compared to Ayres and a few of those players. It must be great to fit into a back line with players such as Langford and Ayres and Mew and these champions.
Oh, it just makes my job so easy. I mean, they're two huge blokes. They just break open the packs, and the rare mistake they make, you know, I can just pick it up, but they're big blokes.
Yeah, there's a story with you that you actually trained with Fitzroy, is that true, and you were discarded?
Well, a couple of years ago I got asked to leave from here. They didn't think I was good enough. I went to VFA for a year, and then I was asked to train with Fitzroy, so I did that for a pre-season, and Hawthorn and Fitzroy couldn't come to an agreement. Went back to Sandy, and then Hawthorn asked me back here.
Bernie Quinlan apparently has got a question for you, Andrew. Yes, Bernie?
You just asked it, Peter. I was going to ask how Andrew happened to get back to Hawthorn after he was tiptoed from Hawthorn virtually the first time. It's a great effort to get back there because he trained very hard at Fitzroy for that pre-season. And it's great to see him back there. He's shown that perseverance, what perseverance can do.
Well, you
and
answered.
He really has achieved something.
Well, you answered the question Bernie was going to ask, how you ended up back at Hawthorn. Also, there was a slight problem with the ankle a couple of weeks ago. In fact, I heard a rumour around there before that you had to have a fitness test on Friday to even play in the game.
Yeah, that's right. I hurt my ankle against Carlton a couple of weeks ago. Actually, Tucky fell on it, and I sprained it fairly badly. I didn't train for most of last week. I was training this week, and it was okay. Then I hurt it again Thursday night, and I just tried to bluff Joycey with it, and I was sort of sitting in the forward pocket with most of the practice, and I thought I got away with it. And after training, he came up and said, "You're limping again." He said, "I think we better do a fitness test." So saw Barry Gavin. He gave me some anti-inflammatories and an ultrasound equipment. So I was up all Thursday night for about 6 hours doing that all night. And lucky I got through the fitness test okay.
Well, it's lucky, Drew. He's a teacher at Marsland College, a great school, Drew. And he's got a week off on school holidays to recover. And tremendous game, Andrew. And I think you've been an acquisition to the Hawthorn Football Club.
Thanks very much, Peter.
And Drew, as we drift out there, prepared to sing the Hawthorn theme song. You ready?
Ready.
One, two, three. We're up in there at Hawthorn.
Where the mighty Hawthorn. That's as bad as his last record.
Thank you.
touch of Aussie rules. Today, groundsmen were up bright and early to remove the goalposts and hopefully some of the miserable memories Demon supporters still have after their humiliating 96-point grand final loss to Hawthorn.
Hawks supporters were in full voice at Glenferrie Oval today to welcome their heroes of yesterday's record-breaking premiership win. For most, the bruises were forgotten as they received the slaps on the back. Others had the obvious signs of battle. Coach Alan Joyce could afford to smile and summed up the players' feelings.
On behalf of the players, to thank you all very much for your support.
Last night, the Hawks celebrated at the club until the early hours of the morning. The Demons booked the Southern Cross, but they didn't have quite as much to smile about. Although Captain Greg Healy promises a higher reward next year.
We came third last year and we're second this year and hopefully we'll be first next year.
Members were hard to find at the MCG today, just a few die-hard supporters.
Beaten but not forgotten.
And it was business as usual for ground staff who cleared away the last visible signs of a footy match.
As the victorious Hawks returned to their heartland.
The most comprehensive grand final win ever. And no matter how young, today was a time for adulation. Of course, there were the bumps and bruises, but no pain as the shopping in Glenferrie Road came to a halt. Also innovators off the field, Hawthorn has made sure the post-grand final parade becomes a regular football fixture. Thousands crammed outside the Hawthorn Town Hall as the spoils of victory went on display. Then it was time for the players, officials and close supporters to really let their hair down at a local hotel. Any premiership player can tell you the feeling.
No, something which you can't buy, something which you can't fabricate. It's just there and it does exist between the blokes here and as I said, we're very fortunate to have that.
The Hawks will make the most of their time for celebration before heading to London next week and back to training for the exhibition against Carlton. Peter Mitchell, 7 News. And